Hello, everyone. It's good to see everyone here to hear the presentation of the National Report on Innovation. The first version was presented 12 months ago, and it focused on a sort of an innovation model for our country. We then identified several lacunas which impair the creation of an innovation-friendly environment in Russia. So, after that, we focused on identifying the key mechanisms to launch, or rather relaunch, innovation process in the country, because this environment used to be there. I believe that our major impediment is that the innovation environment is disjointed. We have several startups and a number of ventures, and still they are not scaled. Therefore, a whole number of new products pop up on the market, but they do not get integrated into a value-added chain through global hubs. So key products would be exported, and then they would become mature and fuller-fledged products elsewhere, not in Russia. In the meantime, Russian companies are procuring integrated solutions from Western countries. However, they do not have an experience or knowledge to work with innovation products domestically. So this disjointed nature of the innovation environment is a major impediment we are faced with. Because otherwise, the more we invest in the design of new products, the more of them we'll lose. The fewer of them we actually launch domestically at major enterprises, which are key to the Russian economy. This is a challenge which we have dealt with for some time. So we have now decided to identify these bottlenecks, the bottlenecks of the innovation environment in Russia. I believe so much for the introductory remarks, and I would like to pass the floor on to Konstantin Polunin, who represents BCG, and for a broader overview of the national report. Thank you. So good morning once again, and I want to extend our season's greetings to you, and hopefully this year will be better than the previous one, particularly in terms of innovation. Well, this is the second version of the national report. Last year, or even the last year but one, in 2015, we launched this report originally in order to provide a broad overview of the innovation environment in Russia and try and get a very down-to-earth understanding of what innovation is. This is a very trite topic, it may seem, on the surface, and still it makes sense to draw on the international experience and compare Russia to other countries. So we identified some of the major tools and instruments which are part of our dashboard, the way we call it, and I don't think we discussed that in much detail with Oleg next to me. I believe that we need to be more specific in our this year's overview and take a general look, sort of a public look on what's been happening to the innovation environment and how can we measure progress and how can we manage change. Once again, this report is not designed as a basis for decision making. It provides an overview, and essentially we offer a set of tools and instruments, dashboards for measuring our progress or lack thereof, which will be conducive to the future policies. Last year, we discussed this report with Prime Minister Medvedev and offered him a progress report. Hopefully, this will become a regular report with new versions appearing at regular intervals. So how is it designed? So the key questions we were faced with is what is innovation and how it can be measured. So both Boston Consulting Group and a large professional community worked out a system of parameters to measure the state of an innovation system. So you can see the innovation environment factors on the left-hand side of this chart, then innovation activity, innovation results, and economic consequences. Then there is a pipeline, a funnel, a classical funnel of sorts, of innovation all the way down to commercialization. Then it can be measured through standard indicators. Now, this is a very crammed chart. So this chart attempts to explain what's been happening in Russia in 2016. So can you see anything? No, you can't. Okay. I will try to explain this, and also I would like to invite you to visit our website. It is publicly available, so methodology is there, the statistics is there for 2015 and 2016. So, bottoms up. From bottom to the top, so we are looking at the taxation regime, how simple it is, and solvency measurement and protection of business rights. Well, these indicators can all be normalized and they're comparable to other countries. All in all, there are around 75 of such indicators. We have compared Russia to a couple dozen of other countries like Israel and France and others. We attempted to compare the state of innovation in Russia and 15 other countries. So red. Whatever is marked in a red circle, it means that there is a discrepancy with these 15 nations more than by a factor of more than 2. Yellow, 1.5 to 2, meaning that we were almost there. Whereas whatever is marked green, these are indicators where we are on par with other countries. Last year, we managed to take a look at how things were changing. We take a look at the dynamic of the innovation environment, of how we're doing as compared to last year and the year but one. Of course, well, the crisis is looming and it affects the overall picture, but, well, it is a straight fact that substantial improvements has been evident in terms of institutional development. We're talking about statistics. We're not talking about plain rhetoric. These are straight facts. Examples. Well, although we are having a very vocal debate as to the quality of education, we are now doing much better than other countries in terms of education quality. Institutional change is also in evidence. This is something that is not immediately visible, and still it is there. The effect of institutional improvement is delayed, and still it will become visible in the near future. So, if we have an environment, this environment is not conducive to growth, this is a very bad thing. We can say that last year we could see some involvement in terms of exports. At the same time, new inventions and new patents have been on the downturn. So what does this actually mean? If we take a look at this in perspective, we would then say that an emphasis was placed on those areas which are characterized by delayed effects. So if you are attaching some efforts to improve educations, you should be able to see the effects in 10 or 15 years' time. Same goes about innovation activity. The government was focused on new technologies and startups and new ventures. And, well, I think we are doing fine here. Well, more or less. However, what Evgeny mentioned in his opening remarks is that this is combined with a limited domestic demand for innovation, which compels people to go and look for their luck elsewhere, not in Russia. Another logical conclusion would be that innovation policy was not properly focused on mature and large businesses. It was focused on startups and venture companies, whereas four years ago, the innovation process began in earnest. So I don't think that we should actually delve too deeply into peers. And still, there is an open question about how could we convert our efforts into tangible results. So what we suggest is this. We believe there are three channels for innovation. One is entrepreneurship. I invented something, I started a business, I registered it, I patented it. I'm an entrepreneur now, I'm churning out a competitive product. I've made a success. The second channel is a venture channel. I have a stash, and I want to make use of the stash in order to invest into a corporate project and launch a venture project. And thirdly, there is a corporate channel. So innovation is designed and developed within a corporation, and then they're brought to the market. All these three channels are there in all the countries. Well, to a different extent, in the United States, they would invent something, then register a business. In this country, a person can design a new, say, contraption, but they are unlikely to go and start a new business based on that. What's new about this chart are the figures. So we've taken our dashboard and tried to break it down to individual elements and connections between them. What I'm trying to say here is that we have innovation products. These products are good for export, and still Russia is lagging tremendously behind other countries in terms of exporting their innovation. Why so? Just because we don't have so many innovation companies. Productivity, the staff size, are comparable to others, and the quantity. We have too few innovation companies that are competitive, that are on a par with their international innovation companies. As compared to other countries, on the average, this factor is seriously smaller than other startups, just because entrepreneurs do not start up their own companies. they do not bring their inventions or ideas onto the market. This is a factor of 9 as compared to other countries. The factor of 9, entrepreneurship channel. Then we say that venture investment is seriously lagging behind other countries. If we take a deeper look at that, we can see that the number of mature innovation companies, and mature is a term. So we have a large number of mature innovation companies. However, the total number of patents and patent applications, so that there is a factor of 37 and factor of 29 respectively, which is a disaster. So we believe that we should mainly be focused on the corporate channel in order to overcome this difficult plight. And what I'm saying is based on statistics. The stats are there, and I do hope that the stats will change soon. I believe that this problem of disjointed innovation will be resolved in the reasonable future by better access to new technology, new products, and new ideas, which will then pull up the rest of the market. So, taking a macroeconomic outlook, we'll see that the share of large businesses in Russia is 79% as compared to 42% in other countries. I believe that we should take a more serious look at the capacity and the role of the large businesses. Yeah, I understand that you might disagree. Well, the share of the public sector. So we take top 10 companies, public companies. So in Russia, their share, their aggregate share is 81%. A deeper analysis, which is required for innovation, would suggest an in-depth look at the innovation activity and a number of quotes per patent. So, well, this is an indication of the quality and quantity of patent. Well, there are three examples for the automotive industry, for oil and gas, and for aircraft building. So, encircled in red means is the small number of patents as compared to other countries. The quality is low. Well, I don't think that things are as bad as they may seem. If we look at the oil and gas, say at Tatneft or Gazpromneft, they are working hard and they are moving forward. They have been evolving technologically. They are now dealing with very complex oil fields, and Gazpromneft is the Bajanov suite, and it is working hard. Avtovaz, which is the flagship of the Russian automotive sector, it doesn't look so badly in terms of the number of patents. Take a look at Hyundai, which is not too a far cry from it.
So, taking a macroeconomic look at this picture, we would see that the share of Russian automobiles in the domestic market went down to 23%. Well, it's understandable that this is not a competitive product. We understand that, we see that, but at least the market share has stabilized, although the commands market share is going up now. Speaking about the aircraft segment, well, I don't remember when it was the last time that I flew by on a Russian-made aircraft. And well, actually, the super jet was mentioned. And well, things are not that bad, as I've said. Well, there are possibilities. There are there's capacity, and so Tatneft, Gazprom, and the automotive business, and Leder Connect is quite a good car. Super jet, Sukhoi, also agriculture, satellite monitoring systems, but unfortunately, what we don't see is a sharp movement forward. We don't see any spurt here. And you see, there are four elements. There are businesses, consumers, markets, suppliers, and subcontractors. Unfortunately, all the agents within the system don't have appropriate incentives and links so that they could move smoothly. Basing on certain canvas results, we obtained this finding that the corporations and individual entrepreneurs are not interested in innovations, and that's unfortunately, we have a very small number of large corporations and companies that are seriously involved in innovative development. If we analyze the economy structure in Russia, we will see that there are defense industry enterprises and some other major enterprises that generate quite impressive and competitive products, but unfortunately, that's it. And so major businesses, major corporations are mainly vertically integrated, so they don't have a sufficient number of suppliers and subcontractors that would encourage them to use innovative approaches. And so those other problems relate to the licensing and standard setting procedures. Well, a lot has been said about these areas, but maybe it's the time for us to start seriously handling these issues. And so we, in addition to the review of various bottlenecks and problems and challenges, we offer quite a number of proposals how things can be improved for the better. So changes in the innovative policies. And the main question is how to set objectives and how to attain such targets. And we focus here on 10 priorities which can be and should be monitored, that the venture investment demand for ready-made technologies, number of patents, number of research projects, and number of research institutes. And why do we identify these specific key components? Because, well, it's very important in terms of data collection, because well all the methodology is available to you in our report and KPI, for instance. Some people think that they are not adequate and let's change them, but then it's not exactly very appropriate. But speaking about highly technological experts, we demonstrate to you such clusters or combined model and how we can apply it in different industries. Here, the Ministry of Trade, the Rosatom, whatever. The question is how to make all these things and schemes work. How to make them truly work and generate. And maybe right now Vasily will join our discussions. And so how can we cascade this product? We understand that we can continue further improving and fine-tuning the existing system. And at the same time, right now in the ministries, we don't see individual responsibility for the failure to attain a collective objective. And so in words, some things and approaches are clear, but in reality, it's not clear who is not responsible or responsible for anything else. So that would require the changes of the entire management hierarchy between and within ministries, we understand that we are not unique here because, well, UK recently has set up an innovation ministry because, again, they noticed that they are facing problems and challenges in the sphere of innovative development. Another mechanism which I would mention, that's the project generating office, and this is a very good instrument. It's quite effective and efficient. In Malaysia, for instance, this approach is quite effective, and we are launching such an office under the aegis of the Russian government. The same experience and expertise can be applied for the innovative development, so that's the will, the resources, the team, and the venue. These are the things which are of paramount importance, and thus it brings me to the end of my presentation, and I believe now we can start the discussion. So we've got to focus our efforts on big businesses, huge corporations. It doesn't mean that we should overlook some other problems and bottlenecks, that we've got to enhance the motivation and the system of stimuli for all the agents in the market, and we've got to define the long-term and short-term horizons in the form of long-term objectives and the action plans that the companies would draw up for themselves. Yesterday, we have published all the press releases regarding the activities of BCG, and we provide assessments of various major drivers of development and economy. Apple ranks first, and there's an analysis of new companies in the market and a very detailed analysis regarding differences between major corporations, global companies, in which they, way they differ from other companies, and because we discuss not only data but also financial indices, and they differ from other agents in the markets because they follow very closely all the innovative developments in the markets, and that's why they react very quickly and they purchase all the promising new ideas and new patents and new products because they act as vacuum cleaner because they set in a system within their corporation that would notice, identify in the market new promising patents, ideas, and products, and they make use of them first in the marketing. Thank you very much, Konstantin, for your report, because you have identified quite a lot of interesting points that we can discuss. And now I would like to pass the floor on to Oleg Fomichev, State Secretary and representing the Ministry of Economic Development, and Vasily Osmakov, who is Deputy Minister for Industry and Trade of the Russian Federation, because let's say we would like to hear about the Ministry of Industry, which controls and supervises all the major innovative programs and projects which are being implemented here. I would only mention that the skill of governing open cycle in innovative programs is a new thing. It's just about 10 or 15 years ago, there was an old room. All the old companies, old timers, completely left markets when a new innovative cycle began. And so when we compare the top 100 companies or corporations at the beginning of last century and those companies, top 100 companies that we could see in the market at the end of the century, they were totally different. But 10 years or so ago, we saw drastic changes in this area. And for instance, NVIDIA company has offered recently artificial intelligence for the automotive business and a range of devices so that the modern vehicles could be controlled and steered by robots. NVIDIA, as you know, that's the company that's generating and producing chips and various computer chips. But 3 or 4 years ago, they understood that this market niche could not ensure their steady development and progress in the future. And now they ventured or branched out into the automotive and robotics industries. So it means that this is a very agile and flexible company, which not only senses the trends in the markets, but can also follow those trends and change their core businesses accordingly. Up to 90% of all companies that exited the market could be explained by the mergers and acquisitions. And so very few of new startups managed to reach the stage of IPOs. And that's a matter of management, strategic governance of major corporations and huge corporations. They have this technology of acquiring smaller and promising companies, and that's certainly a very useful thing that we've got to bear in mind. And now I can pass the floor to Oleg. I will try to be very brief, and so I will just contribute briefly at this point in time, and maybe I'll add a couple of words later on. So we, let's say, in 2010, we started working with major corporations, and basically the questions that we see in this presentation, in this report, were the questions that we focused on in developing our approach. So we had to form a new segment in our economy and venture structures, venture instruments that would help us be very flexible in the market. So if we want to significantly identify the differences and the evolutions within this the system and ensure quite a relatively high innovative growth in our economy, we've got to focus on major corporations that represent state-owned corporations. Well, unfortunately, state-owned participation, state-owned corporations that operate in various industries. So for the past 5 years, 6 years, we've been working along these lines, and I think that we have reached an impasse. Why I'm talking about an impasse? Now, we are trying to supervise and the activities and provide methodology to second level companies, and so when the management signals were sent, some top managers were fired, dismissed, and the some issues were also included in the presidential program regarding the activities of state-owned corporations, also the patent policy, and so such things generated quite adequate top managers that started heading innovative blocks of programs. Then, sometime later, quite appropriate and successful managers of specific blocks of questions appeared, and such innovative or innovations blocks, which were included in the internal structure of the major corporations, still remain a foreign body. Unfortunately, they did not, such blocks did not merge with the rest of the cooperative structure. Now we have reached a level that we understand that we've got to place the chief innovations officer at the level of a CEO, and at the same time, if we talk about the KPI relating to innovative development, even we see if we take into account the better quality. Quality of such activities, and despite all the things that we have planned jointly with the Ministry of Industry and Trade, nevertheless, we cannot really expect a very quick success. And RVK and Rosnano were linked to Ministry of Trade as major industrial corporations. They are not exactly sectoral corporations, but at the same time, we came to the conclusion that it may sound as a paradox, but we do need to enhance the role of the government of the state because, the government or the state does perform its obligations as far as the owner or shareholder of such corporations, but it does not perform its functions of entity as a shareholder that's interested in improving the innovative development. Right now, the task of the government actually is to appoint the top manager of a CEO of a corporation. And then just listen to the plans that the CEO can propose. And now that's actually, we just heard about the short-time planning and the long-term strategic planning. And these things are closely correlates to what we've been discussing and what we saw in our own activities because, the time horizon is like 2 years, sometimes 4 years, because, ministers come and go and CEOs come and go. But if CEOs understand that they would remain in this position for 2, 3, or 4 years, it's not very conducive to developing strategic plans that would last for several decades. And so certainly that should be the task of the government, of the state, to generate strategic programs and propose strategic long-term objectives, and so KPIs and the incentives and methodology and all the other issues. That's something which is related to this strategic horizon of 5-7 years. If the government doesn't know what objectives should be placed developed for this particular company, and this company should be privatized. So what's the purpose of owning such a company if it could be privatized and passed into the private sector? And so speaking about this vicious circle of the lack of long-term objectives and the lack of long-term objectives and the presence of short-term plans. So, some things are being done and only partially. And the second point which I wanted to mention, that's the project office, because let's say last year approximately we saw this solution that if you see any problem, then set up a project office. If previously we talked about commissions and committees, now we are using the term project office. We do have a project office at the federal level, and it's of a very general nature. It's not linked to any specific venues of work. It provides the general methodological unity, the training of staff, the information system, and maintenance of a certain framework. But what we could certainly do is just to generate a project portfolio thanks and with the assistance of our project office, which could be distributed among the ministries depending upon the areas of responsibilities. And certainly we could try and do that by way of a pilot project. We don't need to set up any other project office because, well, this project office will suffice. The question is who should be responsible, who should administrate and supervise such projects. It's a very significant thing.
And these projects should have specific deadlines and monitoring tools. A project office, even 12 months ago, was a very topical issue to discuss. I don't think we should spend too much time on it now. Well, there's very little sense in ruminating over it again and again. Well, project offices are being set up at every ministry, and by the middle of this year, project offices will be operating everywhere. So I believe that what we should really be thinking about is to fit our workings into the project logic. Thank you, Oleg. Let me say a couple of words in addition to what you just said. Yes, indeed. The peers popped up a long time ago first. And I believe they date back to 2011. And, well, this letter to originate peers was largely ignored by companies. Well, as compared to methodologies in these countries, we seem to have a strong penchant for very quick returns. So whenever we launch something, we want to be measuring our progress year on year and fixing returns year on year. Whereas if you want to switch from a passive to active innovation process, it requires something else. I was part of a long discussion on innovation funds, and people were saying that, well, there are 500 innovation funds operating in this country. Most of them were not aware about measuring criteria. There are so many innovation funds that were loss-making, that produced no tangible results, and they do not know how to use their dashboards. After I joined RVK, I went to draw on the US experience, and we were giving so many examples of innovation fund failures. And still, although they were a failure, it was mentioned as a positive experience. Even the Google venture is not a positive thing in financial terms. It is only now that venture funds are profit-making. They are effective, and they are effective not only in terms of money, but the overall improvement of the innovation environment and the viability of new businesses they help create. So what is good about our innovation policy, major corporations and peers, we need to find a way of calculating deferred effects, delayed effects, and we, so that we do not want to see profits in 12 months' time. And now I would like to pass the floor on to Vasily Osmakov, and I'm sure that he has a lot to say. Yes. Well, this is a very good report, and I'm very thankful for its authors. It was most interesting to read it. I will venture a couple of critical remarks first, and then I will pass on to venerating you. Now, let me say this. Can you switch over to the slide of the BCG presentations about the cars and airplanes? That is unbelievable. That slide is truly unbelievable. Yes, right. Let's say about the share of the Russian car market, automotive market. It says that except assembly operations in Russia. You know, several VAZ models may be more foreign than Renault or others. So, well, this statistics just don't make sense. This delineation, so domestic assembly operations or foreign assembly operations as compared to Renault. Well, this is really strange. This is truly strange. Look, the automotive market is truly global, everywhere. And we're switching over to global platforms. And yes, we're trying to increase the share of domestic component and parts manufacturers. Well, like 23%, okay, and it looks okay. And this may be a reflection of the innovation maturity of the Russian market. Well, occasionally it happens that a Russian car model may incorporate a varying amount of localized parts and components. And we're talking about one and the same model. It is just a matter of time or a matter of market situation. Where it comes to aircraft, or the aircraft engineering, please keep it in mind that there is a 20-year cycle in aircraft engineering. So we used to have great airplanes in the Soviet Union and in Russia. So when it comes to the conversion from defense conversion or any other specific requirements, then the 1990s came, then the investment cycle was missed. Then we attempted to launch yet another investment cycle, and it is a 20-year-old cycle. And then the authors of the report are saying that the Sukhoi Superjet is not a success story. So we believe it is. Sukhoi Superjet was included in this report and was marked as a success just because its successor, MS-21, will only fly in 2018. So, proceeding from this comment on aircraft engineering, let me talk about innovation in major corporations. Well, all this talk about innovation development and about major companies treading the innovation path, it goes along the maturing of the public sector in Russia. Because, say, in the Ministry of Industry, consolidation and the setting up of this holding, the ODK and UAK and Rostec and others, they're still in the making. Well, take a look at Rostec. They created a holding organization, and they are now entering a new phase in their development. Think about new venture funds, corporate funds. They're getting involved in high tech and innovation. And this is only logical, because when you are transforming your market environment, we are still in the process of this market transition, mind that. And if we are talking about a company which is managed through administrative measures and is managed by an appointed official who has a very short-term planning horizon, we need to think about switching over to different management technology. It is very deplorable that this presentation did not place enough emphasis on the institutional aspects of innovation. Well, there is a good story about the Kalashnikov concern and how the government withdrew from Kalashnikov and how it was rebranded and how it was totally overhauled. So the most important thing in dealing with public companies is changing their motivation system. And this includes their pricing strategies and setting up non-contradictory government policy. So, when it comes to Oleg's intervention, I think I should supplement it by a new section on the exit strategies. I remember it very well when the UAK was originally set up with an idea that we shall withdraw from it after a short while, and then we will recapitalize it, and then we'll withdraw and let it float, let it steer. Look, yeah, yes, I know that we are prone to crises, and we are susceptible to exaggerated expectations. Yes, I know all that, but the concept is still correct. The concept is there. When it comes to project officers, I don't think that this is a viable initiative, not this year, not in the current situation. Oleg mentioned it. All these processes have been launched by now, and we should wait and see. Wait and see what will come out of it before we get ourselves busy setting up project offices. Here's yet another story I wanted to share about the best thing that happened to Russian innovation lately was economic sanctions and import substitution. Why so? So one major oil and gas companies all of a sudden start to disrupt their project just because they cannot obtain a full solution from a Western licensor. They sit and wait first, and then they start thinking and raking their brain about where to outsource them domestically. And then they start thinking about their domestic component part production, about outsourcing equipment domestically. So we should not underestimate the ingenuity of major businesses. They do what they find beneficial for themselves. However, when they are forced to go another way, when it is impossible to buy an across-the-board solution from a Western vendor, then they sit and think for alternatives. There's one other problem. Large businesses are not quite transparent. They're not open to communication. And normally, major businesses will stealthily buy up startup companies and venture businesses without advertising this too much. They will do that in quiet. And Evgeny mentioned it. When a major fertilizer company branch out into biotechnology, until no one, or major metal-making companies, will start develop new composite materials, and they will tell no one they do this. And I believe that, well, this innovation is going on undercover. It is not just catching the limelight, that's all. Well. I'm sorry. My speech is very sporadic. Well, because I'm making my comments off the margin. I have just one question for the report authors. What do you mean by innovation products? What is this anyway, and how can I measure it? Thank you. Follow-up commentary. are talking basically about one and the same thing. We're talking about company strategy that would be aiming at dealing with strategic investors. The government has never articulated this strategy in their formal documents. It's either you formulate goals and objectives for a company, and then you hire a top manager who will achieve that, or you will set up some KPIs and setting an objective of selling the company to a strategic investor in 24 months' time, whereas our idea is that we hire a top manager for whatever reason, for all the obscure reasons in the world, and then you suggest that he might fiddle here or fiddle there or touch up this thing and don't touch that thing. I don't know why we pursue this policy, why we act this way. We just appoint someone and then we sit and wait until they come to their senses and say, all right, we still have some money to fund your activities. It turns out that we are moving in different directions at the same time. So the Minister of the Economy, coming up with our program, said that we are pursuing these programs, whereas the Minister of Industry said, no way, we're not ready for that. So we can't do that this year. We should wait for some more. Although strategically, yes, yes. Well, basically, they're talking about the same things. However, short-term, they're moving in totally different directions. I agree with Vasily that we have seen some commotion on the market, especially in some extracting sectors, and some companies have started investing in the domestic manufacturers, and they are launching some greenfield projects too. However, we may be faced with yet another midterm risk. That is that a lot of the innovation sector is being very firmly tied to the extracting sector. Now, we are having whole factories with some fixtures which are only working for Gazprom and no one else. There is no other market for them except for Gazprom. So yeah, pipelines are there. It is true. However, the future of this gas pipeline business is very obscure, very uncertain. Well, and considering alternative sources of energy, well, we should not be focusing so intently on hydrocarbons. And we may not be so sure whether we're talking about some spot LNG supplies or new gas pipelines. All this is very uncertain. However, we're building an entire innovation sector around it. Can I say a couple of more words? Honestly, just a couple of words. So, one thing, non-articulated objectives. Well, these privatization programs, which we are working on, is a short-term program. Look, one of my greatest professional achievements is that we will certainly finish the Minprom Avgub. I'm sorry, that was an insider joke. Look, well, when it comes to the maturity of strategists and flexibility of the defense sector and the national security implications, and that the market for defense factories is very special, that's right. It is true. And it will take a lot of time for them to get adjusted. And Kalashnikov, well, after Vaz, and Kalashnikov tried it that way as pilot projects some time ago. And they were conceived within a major mature corporation. And say ministers may be sitting on the board of a whole number of companies, and little by little, well, the fabric of these major corporations has been disintegrating, and well, they're sitting on one page is getting formalized in our official paperwork, like the Ambio management buyout and others. Well, this is getting official now. However, there's a very sensitive issue. You cannot privatize everybody across the board.
As for the risks, yes, truly. This thing does exist, and I specifically focused on this point, that's the imports replacement technologies and plans is another name or another side of innovation development, and that's something that we are going to work on, and measures of support but I would be very careful about underrating the resources sectors, the gas and oil sectors, and because, well, we as for the pipelines, yes, we can perform the diagnostics of the pipes, and then using the servo drives, not import made, for not foreign made. But we would start with the original orders, and then we would build machines and tools in order to manufacture such diagnostic and machinery on our own. Thank you very much for your addition, for your contribution. But jointly with Alexey Krivaruchka, I worked at Autovaz in 2008 when he was senior sales officer, and now he's working with Kalashnikov, and so these are very good examples of how things could be changed, and to certainly to put together and bring together all the objectives and tasks and targets, and then play the role of a shareholder is something difficult, and that's one thing. Secondly, I hear and I see lots of developments, evolutions as far as the creation of environment goes, the creation of new instruments. But let's talk about tourism, for instance. What does tourism have to do with innovations and innovation development? But I will tell you the link between them. The share of tourism in the Russian market, national economy, is 10 billion rubles. And let's say, if we analyze everything through the looking glass of tourism, we would see that the global tourism market grew 1.5 times. And so what's the share of Russian in outgoing tourism? It went down two times. Because certainly we can wait until certain evolutionary processes get complete, but we don't have this time, and maybe we vice versa could use the changing global situation in order to develop appropriate industries, including tourism. Thank you. And let's move on, dear colleague. So one of the major points mentioned in this report relates to the optimization of administrative or managerial impact, governance impact. There was one very good chart that was mentioned, very wild ratios, let's like 29 times lag from the samples taken in other countries in the leading economies. And there are some areas in the patent sphere where we lag behind behind over 30 times. And so that's a very good example of coordination between different development programs. So there is, let's say, we have publications on project development and innovative development published in domestic magazines by researchers and actually we saw the results that the patents were going down, and those which were registered in Russia, because the entire licensing and patent registration procedures are so complicated that researchers prefer to publish their innovations in magazines, in literature, and make this information available to other markets. And corporations from China, for instance, and from Japan, they picked up these new ideas and focusing on such publications, they patented these ideas. And now I will pass the floor to another participant, and I will try to answer the question about that you raised, that Oleg Borisovich raised. The Open Government and the Government Council are paying a lot of time to working with the state-owned companies. So that's the PERs UAKs and some other things. But the devil is in details. On the one hand, the peers were created and the requirements as far as their contents were toughened. Yes, we did create and set up KPI, which is accounts for a large portion of remuneration payable to the top managers. But again, we see a discrepancy between tenures of top managers and members of the board, the directors on the boards. And that's a problem that needs streamlining. And another point which was mentioned in line with this report is not to change the general trajectory, the itinerary, and and to try and keep up the pace. We cannot slow down our process. Another matter lies with the creation of a pool of top managers that would be aware of new needs and innovations, and another task relating to the human resources. A problem is how to acquire and how to educate and train new grafs and Solovyovs. And so we certainly are interested in having our flagship corporations in every industry. And we understand that we do need to change the existing system. And that's why we do support the idea of priority projects. And one of the task is to monitor the dashboard of innovations, and it should be done at the very top, and the composition of such indicators, because we do have lots of indicators in the innovation strategy until 2020, and basing on this strategy, we did try to harmonize the all the factors and top priorities relating to it. And we believe that the next step would be using the federal project office as the main venue, as an umbrella, to unite various major organizations in the development of such targets and objectives. So we've got to leave behind this total irresponsibility or collective irresponsibility as far as final outcomes and outputs go. And at the same time, we've got to keep up the pace of development. So we are now working on the list of such projects, and very soon we're going to finalize it and present it to the government. And in practice, we should certainly be very active. I also urge you to join actively join the discussion of this national report, because the national report is posted on our website. So we are ready to include in the final version of our list of pilot projects all those proposals that you may feel necessary to add in the comments. Thank you very much. Thank you. And so let's proceed. We have a number of other experts that represent the companies, corporations, and innovation instruments. And now I will give the floor to Andrei Zuzin, who is managing director of the Web Innovations Foundation. And so, dear colleagues, I'm sorry for being late. And so, I have the only excuse is that it's Friday the 13th. I have, unfortunately, I haven't seen this version of the report, but I certainly have read the previous versions of this report. Listening to deputy esteemed dear deputy ministers and our colleagues that spoke before me, I can say that we are certainly in our organization, that's the Foundation Web Innovations, we have 20 companies on the portfolio, and the portfolio is quite balanced in terms of industries. So six companies paid back the money that was invested in their activities, which is quite fairly good as far as the venture markets go. I would like to examine the entire situation from the top, the government level. It's very good that we see the localization of Western companies in Russia, and in addition to Autovaz, for instance. It's not an they are not innovative corporations or businesses. They are rather, let's say, modernization projects. And so, Autovaz is trying to join this trend, the processes are still quite modest. If we want to implement special investment projects, then we have to answer the question whether Russian domestic companies they manufacture competitive, globally competitive goods and products. And so this inclusion in the global ecosystem defines our selection of senses, let's say, and the appetite to risk. If we compare it to Japan, well, basically the appetite for risk is quite low, as far as Japan goes. But nevertheless, so all the companies and the goods that they manufacture are quite competitive, and that's exactly it means that they do generate their own policies. And so, China, for instance, they also do quite a lot in order to insist on their own decisions and solutions for new companies. They're just coming into the market. Israel, again, lots of companies and the main sales market for the produce of such Israeli companies is the United States. And so we also hear today the expansion of the time horizon. So unless we do that, unless we want to venture outside the boundaries of the Russian Federation, then what can we talk about? How can we compare the competitiveness of different organizations and corporations of different products? Let's say Rosneft sells oil and delivers oil. Gazprom delivers gas. And so we've got to identify some other criteria that would be competitive, let's say, and would could be measurable in the global terms. Aeroflot, for instance, it's quite competitive and it operates very nicely in the global market. We mentioned the steel making industry and retail trade sectors, and so will the telecom companies with the ICT corporations. There you would see a very minimal government regulation because, well, they have their own internal incentives in order to use and produce innovations. And so they have to compete in not only in the domestic markets, but also in global markets. Those examples that we cases that we have in Russia, I don't mean to be critical, but if we forget about the news shown on TV about what things are happening in Russia, let's just look at Russia as a major, huge venture project. So what we are doing here, we are assessing the risks in those initiatives, in those spheres, which are not demonstrating the expected results, but at the same time, we've got to move ahead and introduce those initiatives that we already have. So we may hear lots of critical things about Skolkova. But if we stop this major project, then again, we will have to start from scratch and begin a new cycle of debates and theoretical discussions. Another thing which is important for Russia to decide on, that's the sources of funds for innovations under the circumstances of such sanctions that have been imposed on Russia. So what should the government do, whether to issue some grants, whether to set up some privately owned funds, foundations, and use private money. But let's admit frankly, with the exception of the IT industry, very few investment come from the private sector. Let's say those projects which are very liquid, which can migrate or move across the borders quite easily, they do cross the borders. And so it may be a paradox, but the government, which I also represent, never issues the required required amount in order to fund an investment project, but it just that gives a portion, allocates a portion of this required amount with the requirement of attracting other sources of funding for the implementation of such innovation projects. Well, I have another interesting case. That's the push-out innovation in the Rostech Corporation. So the company has very good management team. They understand what they should do and how to proceed. They are starting to look for appropriate markets outside Russia. And they are quite successfully not only searching for, but finding good partners outside Russia. And so let's say people understand this. People understand that they've got to use the M&A technique abroad in order not only just to organize the production cycle abroad, but in order to also ensure their presence in the markets. That's about all that I wanted to say. Thank you. Starting last year, jointly with the Ministry of Economic Development, we've been surveying those companies and corporations that are venturing in global markets by using relying on M&A principle, and so they do acquire local foreign corporations and manufacturing facilities, whatever. But certainly, we understand that that's something. that, let's say, well, Russian market accounts for 2% at best of the global markets. And so the IT market is developing very quickly. It's developing quickly, expanding. But nevertheless, we have to think about longer-term horizons. And we've got to think about champions, how we can educate and how we can nurture such champions. But let's go back to the interaction between major corporations and the innovation market. And let me give the microphone to Vladimir Kosteev, who represents the Club of Directors in the sphere of science and research and innovation.
Dear colleagues, I don't want to take too much of your time, so just a couple of words. So, are major Russian companies innovation-focused? Yes, they are. However, we're talking about this follow-up innovation. This is not the kind of innovation we are expecting from them, not in the sense that we would like them to innovate. Well, they're not innovation in the global market sense. The fact is that the entire innovation management system is based on risk minimization. Well, the market is ever-changing, and well, there are some new methodologies, like the internal R&D projects and government orders and risk management. All this is something that conserves company management. Well, we have been talking about long-term objective settings and incentives, motivation. I would add a couple more things. I believe that the government should pay attention to those. One thing is what Anna was saying, is where do we identify change leaders? The leaders that would join major companies and will assume the risk of innovation. Except for the major education, global education system, I can see no other option. It's either that we start retraining our managers at all levels, starting with corporate lawyers that would sanction all transactions, the bookkeepers and accountants that would oppose innovation just because this is not the way they used to work, all the way to shareholders and independent members of the boards. All this should be achieved as a government effort. I believe that we need to thoroughly retrain existing companies to adapt to innovation. And yet another thing is that we should identify risk zones. Well, the system of regulation currently in place is poorly adapted to risk-taking. So, for instance, well, there are some companies that want to innovate in the utility sector, and there are no testing grounds for them, no pilot areas, no construction companies will ever admit them on their construction site. So there is no place that could come out and test their innovation projects. They cannot launch some pilot projects, the oil and gas innovation companies, having a trough just because no one would allow drones in the oil fields. No one would allow new turbines to be tested on-site at new power plants. And without this certification, they will never be launched in production. So this is a kind of a vicious circle. So why are they buying full solutions from the West? Just because, well, there are better opportunities for the West to test and trial innovation. I'm saying, why don't the state, the government, allow the companies to channel some of their dividends in the in-house innovation funds? Say, at least 50%. Of their dividends. or something from the other 50%, and they should be tax exempt, exempt from a profit tax. However, public companies should be allowed to take a risk and to risk company money. If we do not allow them to do this, we will never be able to build a management system. Modern, advanced management systems that would be well adapted to high risk investment and innovation projects. That is about it. Thank you. Thank you indeed. Now we have two more speakers, two more experts coming from innovation companies, or I would rather say from those companies that are engaged in high-tech production. Dmitry Ivanov from the NPO Saturn. So we have worked with them for a very long time. So please share with us. Hello, colleagues. It's good that you let me sit for a while and cool off, because I'm burnt out by now, and I will not be so much critical as I intended to be from the beginning. Well, look, well, the picture you're drawing is not based on appropriate statistics. Let's start from R&D, research and development. In Russian companies, R&D is not the same as R&D in Western companies. We're talking about patent activity. However, in Russian or in public companies, the result of their R&D efforts is not a number of patents. It is just paperwork, not more than paperwork. And this paperwork can be either marketed or not marketed, or stashed away in some place in a closet, and that is all. And the money appropriated by the state for R&D is not investment. It is regarded as the revenue of a design office. So, look, I've made 5 billion this year. I said, hi, I've produced R&D for 5 billion. So did they invest this 5 billion someplace? No. There was a design office with 3,000 people on the staff. They produced some paperwork. What happened to it? Nothing. Nothing happened to it. It's still gathering dust on the shelf, that paperwork. So this is not research and development. We are just indulging in illusions that we're spending money on innovation development. No, we're not. It's like what Vasily said. So what do you mean by innovation product? Tell me again. If you say that what our companies are churning out are innovation products, then you are sitting pretty. Then you are doing very well. However, if we are talking about global patents, international patents, then I am sorry. Probably something is seriously out of whack in our innovation sphere or in our R&D sphere. So we shouldn't be simply saying that Aeroflot is an excellent company. Yeah, it is just an average international company. Well, okay, it is not in the top 10 or whatever. If it is, yes, what is it about? Profit margin or good customer feedback? No, look, well, this is customer feedback, not more than that. However, if you measure it by business standards, if you go to Wikipedia and say that Ryanair, just compare Aeroflot and Ryanair. And after we checked our stats, we could discuss how efficient Aeroflot is. Look, this is very fundamental. This is all very basic. Well, next, this innovation program. Innovation development program. How is it integrated in the business of any company? The answer is simple. It is not. So the innovation development director is an appendage to the corporate structure. They're not part of the core business. So every innovation, every R&D, every investment comes from the budget. And how would budget be related to peer? In no way. It is not even approved by the company management. How is it connected to a company strategy? It is not connected. So, an innovative development director is just an appendage. He is just a person sitting at his desk and writing his papers, writing his memos. So he's producing memos for the board of directors. Now that's all. KPI, and whether we need to introduce joint liability. Yes. Being an innovation director, I was instructed to use two KPIs and the ratio of the planned R&D expenditure and actual R&D expenditure, and the planned retooling budget and actual retooling budget. Those are all KPIs. I was boiling for 2 days. I decided to write a fuming memo to the board of directors, and then I thought better of it. And I decided that we cannot really do anything about that. This is because these appropriations are already approved, and there's very little, if anything, you can do about it. So it's either you start an open conflict with your finance director, and why do you want to spend money on the payroll and not on the R&D? I will get my bonus for meeting my KPIs, which is good, yes. But that is the only thing that is good about it. So I'm afraid that our results are not meaningful. I believe that we should not look at it from top to bottom, but from bottom to the top. Well, innovation development programs are very good, but to be meaningful, they need to be integrated in the company core business. This should be a mandatory document. And secondly, we should be talking about patents and startups. We should not really be talking about some routine operations. Otherwise, we can make believe that we spend a lot of money on R&D, but that money will stay within the design office. There will not ensue any positive developments, and then design offices will keep a lot of people on their staff. And if they keep a lot of people on their staff, they will not outsource anything. We should make this R&D appropriations investment, and then you will be able to talk about efficiency. Don't talk about innovation. Do you think that General Electric talks about innovation? No. No, please, I assure you. They are talking about the yields and the dividends. And then the secondary issue will be innovation and everything else. However, if our corporate strategy says that we need to perform our state orders by 100%, and that is all, so what comes next? What kind of innovation are we talking about? And that's it. I think I have talked enough to be fired promptly. Thank you. I believe that best interventions, when they're moaning and whining. Well, I loved that intervention. I really did. Totally constructive. So it was illustration of our report item by item, which means that companies did not produce an innovation organization or innovation framework. So when people come to our ministry to take part in our meetings, they said that, well, innovation is integrated in the company business. However, much will depend on the companies themselves. And why your R&D is not R&D, but your CEO will probably have a say and will be able to change the situation. I believe that companies should have a say in that. And, well, there is this one simple word which is called leadership. We have a problem with leadership in companies. I think that nearly all companies we are dealing with are faced with this problem. Well, generally speaking, to make people do innovation sounds like nonsense. And still, the government needs to push it ahead. Yes, this intervention was just about it. And I believe that there is a lot of disjoint between our proclaimed objectives and the actual strategies and programs of action. We analyzed operations of one company which was engaged in very interesting research and development. However, after a short while, they procured a full solution from their Western partner, although they had a better solution, which was developed in-house. They did, and still they chose to purchase it from a Western partner. Because people would normally treat their innovation units as like as a utility and as a social subsistence. Having said that, some research centers, would come out to play on this niche, and they would tend to buy services. To buy a full across-the-board service, you need to integrate it first. So many Russian companies have started playing in that field. And universities are saying that they receive those systems integrators and they would be more reasonable, more sensible people to talk to. So when companies are starting to looking at third-party decisions and getting them integrated in their own processes, this may be a very good thing. And now I request that Andrei Bezrukov takes the floor and talks about innovation. He is the owner of a company which does a lot of good things in the innovation business. We are a privately owned company, not a penny from the state coffers. We engage in electronics. I believe Dmitry has already said what he wanted to say. I do not think that I should be excessively critical at this point. I would rather make a couple of compliments. So we see that the electronic market is recovering a little, at least. Well, there are a lot of people that started coming up and asking questions. I said, just in case, would you be able to produce this or that? I said, just in case we would.
Second, speaking about the regional level, we see that the innovation agenda program is being developed and is shaping up. Nevertheless, such programs may acquire even comic forms. Let's say I receive a telephone calls from the deputy head of the of a certain municipality, and he says that they have got to introduce new practices of municipal management because you are aware of such things. Will you come up to us and explain what we are talking about, what we have to do? So, well, that's something really comical. But nevertheless, at least it's the positive thing is that the regional authorities and municipal authorities at least are aware of this information, and they know that they will have to do something along these lines. So we have invited 200 engineers to Kaliningrad, and they acquire a very good housing conditions. They come with families, and so their families would have small children, and small children should go to kindergartens and then to schools, etc., etc. So we have to create very comfortable conditions, living conditions for such experts. And that means that we've got to bear the burden of, let's say, taxation, the the cost of land, the construction of private housing, kindergartens, schools, etc., etc. And so I really thought that we were first, let's say, pioneer in this area. But now, let's say, another company, we are restoring the city of Gusev in Kaliningrad region. And we, there is another major company that is restoring the city of Miais. And so say, they sent me a very interesting letter by email saying that, let's say, it's just well from Miais, it's a two-flight, a two-hour flight to Moscow and a four-hour flight to Vladivostok and 10-hour flight to the Silicon Valley. And so that's how they proposed to work. And so we asked them whether they had developed a certain algorithm of working jointly with the government, with the state. No, they said, no, we are just relying on open markets, on the internet. And in Chelyabinsk, another company that they are sort of creating their territorial innovation cluster that's responsible for the social and cultural projects, let's say, because, well, this is a very important area for those engineers that, in their turn, are generating those clusters and working on projects and providing innovative ideas. What I mean to say is that we've got to support such companies and to provide assistance to them in their work when they want to focus on social and cultural issues. Thank you, dear colleague, for this very interesting addition, because, well, the government, the state, when stimulating certain innovation projects, starts telling such companies what to do and where to sell their products. But certainly we see that the IT industry is developing at a very fast pace, and the experts of our IT industry going up very quickly. But we see now wonderful colleges and universities that educate and train students and then produce graduates in the IT sphere. But still, we lack human resources. We lack experts in the IT sector. A friend of mine just told me that Visa, this international payment system, decided to diversify not only just to issue cards, but venture outside into some other business. And so they made calculations, and they require 5,000 program writers. So in the Silicon Valley, there are just, well, 200 program writers, and so they require 5,000. And so where to look for the required number of software program writers? And so they decided to travel to India and to see whether this solution, a certain solution, may be provided. They met with representatives of universities and the Ministry of Education in India, etc. And so it was tackled as a project. So within the next 5 years, they would be able to produce from universities and colleges, well, they required 5,000 software programmers. Thank you. My question is, do you agree that the government can do everything because, well, the government represents the interests of all this strata of population, major companies, big businesses, small businesses, and et cetera, and the individuals? And second, maybe, do you think that would be correct to introduce certain internal domestic sanctions, since we all complement those sanctions that were imposed on us? And so the government has to identify big-scale tasks and quite high objectives, and only then we could draw on our own capacity, individual capacity that pertains to all the organizations. Just look at China. Look at the scale and the scope of objectives that China has generated and placed for herself. And now we don't see such the same scope here in Russia. Unfortunately, entrepreneurs have only one chance, one attempt in the market. Otherwise, we will go out of the market. We will not be effective. So we have to manage and administer our country on our own, and that's why it's up to us to do that. So, Oleg, what can you say about the capacity and the possibilities of the state? I will paraphrase yesterday's phrase that, well, the government can do everything, but if we start doing that, well, you will rule the day, you will complain a lot. And so I don't think that the point that you made about, let's say, one single attempt that an entrepreneur can make, that's something that I cannot agree completely, because, well, entrepreneurs have lots of attempts in order to, and so they are given lots of chances to work in the markets. And as far as the single strategy goes, well, yes, we are working on it, and by the end of the year, we hope to have it, but we are just not, you will not see some major global project like a nuclear project and lunar solar projects and etc. The same applies to China and to the United States, because, well, businesses should not go to the government and ask the government, tell us what to do and where to work, but they've got to generate profit and for their own activities and generate appropriate living conditions and welfare for the population of the respective countries. The government should create and ensure the relevant and appropriate conditions for the operations of such businesses, and also certainly provide a wide sphere, wide field for innovations. And it that the government is doing that, because we do have our innovation development instruments, and it's also, let's say, a system of remuneration and incentives for businessmen and for the, those top-ranking people who represent such companies and who are involved in these activities, and they are responsible for the implementation of major projects. And certainly the government will continue investing not only in the defense industry and the aircraft industry and the space and satellite industry, but in other spheres as well. But the, we should not forget that private businesses should mostly rely on their own resources, including their own planning, because, well, it doesn't work this way when businesses come to the government and say, tell us what to do. Okay, thank you. I would argue that about the necessity for certain challenges and mega objective tasks or mega objectives. Well, it's true that we cannot wait from the government to formulate certain projects, like 70, 60 years ago, the Manhattan Project or nuclear project, and under the aegis or from under the umbrella of this project, they would be distributing tasks between different corporations. Well, economies don't work this way right now, but now the governments and states have another instrument that's possibility to make long-term plans that would generate incentives to the appearance, formation of new businesses. Let's say, for instance, well, like the Netherlands. The Netherlands said that they would like to cut down the consumption of gasoline and oil. It means that, okay, within a certain period of time, they would be focusing and generating and producing electromobiles, electric cars. And a lot depends on the international distribution of labor. Well, certainly such major projects when, let's say, trends and industries are changed, like generation of LNG and substitution by LNG piped gas, etc. And so certainly such projects and program require a very long time span, but long-term projects at the same time of such a scope, when you assess and forecast the investment instruments, the rate of return, and the markets, and this and the output. That's certainly very important. I have studied this issue, and certainly in the United States has such programs regarding creating stimuli and incentives to specific industries. That's, let's say, a British innovatives and technologies. Also in China, they also have similar programs. And so, let's say, China sees itself as a country that manufactures robots and is run by robots. And so we do have a strategy in Russia, a strategy of the national innovative development and all the programs which specify the major objectives of such strategies, but such strategies truly become viable when only we have a dialogue between private businesses, private sector, and the public sector, and when we have PPPs, and so the government should be responsible for its own area, scope of authority, and businesses are responsible for their own objectives and duties. And we've got to certainly understand that, and it brings me back to the national domestic champions that should evolve into global champions, etc. Well, basically, it's not an argument. Well, I fully agree with you, but I meant very specific projects that the government would be monitoring and would be a sort of inviting private corporations and companies to join. A couple of words about this report and a question concerns this systemic mistake that I noticed. Can you assess the number of inventors and the holders of other creative solutions that could enhance the science intensity or innovation intensity of the market? I rely on the Soviet experience, because in those days there was a huge number of inventors that were involved in the actual industrial manufacture. I didn't see this figure here. Well, we use only the statistical data provided by Rospatent. We don't have any other. So I see a systemic mistake in this report, namely the channels which relate to governance is very finely described. These are big businesses, big corporations. All the other entities which are responsible for the use of resources and for generating products is not mentioned. I know a large number of individual inventors that just cannot find their way within the intricate corridors of this patent procedures. So So the question is, you mentioned the systemic mistake. So the systemic mistake, in my opinion, is just do you see a way out of this situation, and how can you use individual inventors? Yes, let me just add follow up on that. There was a third channel mentioned in this report, and I advise you and urge you to read it on our website, because well, the main channel, the main industry channel, becomes independent right now, let's say, and we're not talking only about the major corporations, but the main consumption channel, that's certainly it is limited to major corporations, because well, the initial original corporate innovation developments are shrinking down in numbers, and this is a normal trend, and we can see this trend everywhere in other countries of the world, because well, it relies to let's say the using some other facilities like venture foundations, venture funds, and some brokerage companies, etc. So I don't see any systemic. In Switzerland, the capitalization of innovations is four times higher than in Russia, and these are annual parameters. Can you explain why it happens? I think that we cannot focus on the most successful inventions. For instance, the theory of bots, which is working very well in Switzerland, but is not working in Russia, but it was invented in Russia. Well, I apologize. Maybe I do not did not understand your question. What did you mean when you said the capitalization of innovations? That's the revenues, annual revenues. Well, yes, the situation in Russia is worse than in Switzerland, and we've got to do something with that. Well, I just cannot answer your question. Why? Things are better in Switzerland. Why are things in this area are worse in Russia? Because well, the systems are built differently. Well, I can say a few words about Switzerland. In Switzerland, let's say like 30 or 40 years ago, it's a significant number of years ago. So quite a long time ago, Swiss universities became partners of major corporations regarding the implementation of specific projects. There is a division of labor between universities and corporations regarding generation of new technologies. So when major corporations found a shortage or identified a shortage of their own new ideas, they immediately turned to universities. And so that's collaboration between universities and big corporations became the best example. And so this experience was replicated in Germany and in some other countries in Europe. And so speaking about the startups, so they're quite few in Switzerland, but nevertheless, they are very good. They have very good clusters for mid-sized companies, and this this is a finalized model, this collaboration between universities and corporations, and this model is working very well in various clusters, because well, this why the question is why this model is not effective in Russia, because we do not have such a model on the national level. No one can force a university to build such a model in various industries, but no one prohibits universities and big corporations to establish permanent links and collaboration and resolve the problem of innovation. And let me answer this. And so if there is a dashboard presentation, and you can show it on the screen, and immediately you can understand why the things in Russia are here in the sphere of innovations is worse than in Switzerland. So just will change red into green, and here this, you would get the picture of the situation in Switzerland. And my last question that I would And the question is to representatives of our ministries and Mr. Fomichev. Citing Oleg Fomichev, the government has to assume the responsibility for setting objectives. And Vasily, the government does not articulate the challenge, the problem. And we also, generate controversial tools and instruments. So the impression is that the government is somewhere very far. But we, citizens and individuals, we believe that the government is represented by you. It's sort of when you say about some, some abstract government.
Yes, of course. Of course, we are ready to deal with that issue. I am not a Louis XIV to say that l'état est moi. Yes, we are working closely amongst the ministries. And I am saying that while there is miscommunication between ministries and state departments occasionally, but you can count on us. Any complex management system, the state is a complex system, is not a magic wand. So if you want good setting, then you get gold setting. Now, we're talking about voluminous laws, bylaws, regulations, and personnel. When I took the floor, I wanted to emphasize that public companies are getting more mature than before. But this is not going to happen very quickly. It's not like we're so together, the president and the president, like, say, have this done tomorrow, overnight. We are just sowing the field. Perhaps this will bring me outside the framework of our discussion. We have been preoccupied in criticizing public companies, and the next panel discussion will be criticizing the state, not public companies. And please just trust me. The state oftentimes are faced with a lot more internal problems than public corporations. And it is not all that simple. Like Vasily said, the state is not a homogeneous entity. It is not something that operates as a single mechanism. It is very complex. And there have been a lot of disruptions and failures on this way. Yes, we do have a lot of problems with our day-to-day management. Colleagues, this brings us to the end of this panel discussion. Thank you very much for your questions. Goodbye.